All right, joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. Senator Gatchalian, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to our televiewers.
All right, you were one of the 19 senators who voted for the Maharlika Investment Fund. Why did you vote for it?
Well, Karen, first of all, I am in favor of growing our economy through infrastructure. One of the directions and objectives of the Maharlika Investment Fund is to invest in infrastructure. And looking at the various PPP projects here in our country, especially on infrastructure, it seems to me that infrastructure is also a profitable business. So the Maharlika Investment Fund has a twofold objective. One is to invest in infrastructure, and number two, invest in profitable infrastructure so that it will get returns that can, again, go back to the economy or reinvest in infrastructure. So in simple terms, Karen, I'm just explaining in simple terms. That's the reason why I voted in favor of the MIF.
Okay, Senator, let's draw up certain specifics when it comes to the bill passed by the 19th Congress. The most crucial amendment, of course, in the Senate's version is to remove the pension funds as a source for the seed funds of the Maharlika Fund. And yet President Marcos Jr. says, all right, they won't be used as a seed fund. SSS, GSIS, PhilHealth, Home Development Mutual Fund, OWA, Philippine Veterans Affairs Fund, but they can choose to invest in it. So it means at some point, if they want to invest in the fund, they can. Now, Senator Rafi Tulfo asked for a specific amendment to remove. He said, except SSS, etc., etc. What is the final copy? Can SSS and the others still invest in the fund along the way?
Karen, this is a very emotional issue for everyone, especially for our constituents. Personally, here in Valenzuela, whenever I encounter retirees, both from government and from the private sector, this is a very emotional topic for them. For all of our retirees, almost all of our retirees, this is the only source of income for them. So they don't want to put their income at risk or their pension at risk. So this is a very emotional issue for many of us. So in that speech that I heard given by the president, it has been overtaken by events. The Senate version has categorically prevented
banned
SS, GSIS, and all the similar pension funds from investing in MIF.
Okay.
This is the most popular, by far, the most popular amendment of the senators. In fact, many senators amended this. Senator Tulfo, Senator Bato was the first one who actually stood up and amended this. Senator Pia Cayetano, Senator Lauren Legarda. Many senators proposed amendment to prevent the pension funds from investing into the MIF.
And the Senate version, Senator Sherwin, is investing in the future, not to be used as a seed fund. Pero kumbaga kahit a year from now, 2 years from now, let's say the fund is doing well or not doing well, the Senate version is it prevents investment from these pension funds, period.
Yes, current and in the future. But it's important to note, Karen, that SSS and GSIS now can invest in equities, both listed and non-listed. So in other words, at the present charter of SSS and GSIS, they can invest in profitable companies. But with this particular amendment, both pension funds and the others, no, like veterans and the others, cannot invest in MIF anymore. Whether MIF makes tons of money or not, they cannot put money in MIF.
Uh-oh. So, Senator, can the president veto that particular part of the bill, or he would have to return the whole bill?
No, this is not a revenue measure.
Okay.
The president can only veto revenue measures and the appropriation measures, the General Appropriations Act. They can veto. They can do line vetoes. But for this particular bill, no. The president needs to return this to Congress if he doesn't agree with certain provisions of the bill. So we have to redo everything again. We have to start from scratch if he vetoes the approved version.
Okay. So is it right to say, Senator, that even the House version coincides with the Senate version of all pension funds cannot invest in the future? Is it the same?
No, Karen. Mm. The House version is wildly different from the approved Senate version.
Yeah.
I think it's almost probably 80% different. I'll give you an example. In the House version, the pension funds were mandated to put money. Mm-hmm. But in the Senate version, we prevented the pension funds from investing money. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the big differences between the House version and the Senate version. But then again, no, the House concurred to adopt the Senate version. So in other words, they mm-hmm. agree to the provisions of the Senate version. Now it becomes one bill approved by Congress
yes.
as a whole.
Okay, so that's one issue. The other issue is I interviewed yesterday Professor Solita Monsod, and we've heard the thoughts of Diwa Gunigundo, also former cabinet officials, economists and analysts who said, it's not clear really where the bill is meant to invest. Speaker Martin Romualdez said at one point, we will look for guidance to the PSE on investing in blue chip stocks. So if you're investing in the PSE, some analysts felt, you're investing the same. That's not really a big win if we really want a game changer for the Maharlika. Is it clear where the Maharlika Fund can invest?
Yes, Karen, the declaration of policy is very clear. You know, for economic development, to reduce poverty, Senator Cayetano introduced a very good, Senator Pia Cayetano introduced a very good provision on sustainability. And that's the trend right now, investing in sustainable business endeavors. So the bill is very clear in terms of the direction. The declaration of policy will dictate where they will invest. They cannot just randomly invest in different companies or different projects. It has to be in line with the declaration of policy. Mm-hmm. But we also have to take note that part of the risk mitigation of a fund is diversification. That's already an agreed principle in fund management. Mm-hmm. So, in other words, there's a direction for economic development, but at the same time, we're not restricting the fund to diversify in other projects so that it can mitigate risk. I'll give you a very specific example. If the fund invests 100% of its money to infrastructure and the economy slows down, there's no one going out driving their cars, then the fund will have a big problem. So in other words, risk mitigation through diversification is also part of the flexibility that we gave the fund.
Okay. And the seed fund is now at 500 billion pesos. Is this correct?
The authorized capitalization is 500. The subscription or the paid up is 125. To be paid up in the next 5 years.
And where do the senators envision where the 500 will come from?
First of all, it will be Land Bank will contribute 50 billion.
Okay,
DBP will contribute 25, mm-hmm. and the balance will be contributed from the dividends of the BSP, mm-hmm. PAGCOR, and privatization, GOCCs, and other royalties.
Okay. And you believe because Land Bank and DBP are fixed, that the BSP and the rest, that it will amount to 500 billion as a whole?
In the 500 billion, there's no timetable to that.
Okay.
It really depends now. Like, for example, if it declares dividends, then those dividends can be plowed back in. For example, if PAGCOR declares a bigger dividend, so it's the balance of 375 It will depend on how the fund will be operating and how the fund will be profitable in the future.
All right. Now, let's talk about how who sits at the board and how the corporation, so to speak, will be managed. What is the final in the bill? I know one is given the fact that those who should sit and join shouldn't have present cases, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, that's standard.
Yes, standard na yon. But who chooses, for example, let's start first with the setup. What's the setup in the Senate version?
Well, in simple terms, Karen, I'll put it very simple. There's an advisory council, and there's also the board. And it's important to note that the board, there are three independent directors there. No, and the independent directors are meant to balance the board members from Land Bank, board members from DBP, who are government employees, no? Mm-mm. And then there's also, it's very important to note that aside from the governance standards, I think the most important safeguards there is the audit mechanism, no? Because you have the governance, but who audits the governance, no? So in the Maharlika, in the MIF bill, it's important to note that there are four levels of audit that was prescribed in the bill. No? And this is one of the most, in my experience, both in the public and the private sector, it's one of the most airtight in terms of audit. You have the audit committee. Before, it was just an audit group, but it became a committee. We elevated into a committee, which is chaired by an independent director, not chaired by one of the government employees. There's an external audit, meaning these are the PricewaterhouseCoopers, these are the international auditors. There's an internal audit, you know, which is built in the company. And on top of that, COA has the power to audit it.
Okay.
So there are four audit mechanisms that will audit the fund and that will audit the governance of the fund.
Okay. Now, Senator, based on the Senate measure, just, in broad strokes, who does the president appoint? Does he appoint anyone?
Well, the government, the president appoints, obviously, the DBP and the Land Bank.
They're members of the board.
But right, members of the board,
okay,
right.
That's a given. Probably it's the head. But right. In terms of who's running the corporation?
There's an advisory council that in the bill, the advisory council recommends to the president who to appoint. You know? And the advisory council is composed of the different secretaries, the economic secretaries. And they recommend to the president and the president appoints. But on the qualities and the qualification of the appointees, those are specified in the bill. Mm-hmm. So it's also, you cannot just appoint anyone off the street. No, there's qualifications in the bill that the advisory council should fulfill, and the president appoints from that list that the advisory council gives.
Okay.
It's also important to note, Karen, in the original version, the MIC, you know, which is the managing corporation, is exempted from GCG, you know, governance council of the government. You know? And in the Senate version, we brought it back. So, in other words, the MIC is not exempted to the coverage of the GCG. Mm-mm. And the GCG exercises what they call the fit and proper rule, which is making sure that the appointees are qualified. Mm-hmm. No? And that's another layer of mechanism to make sure that the president appoints the most qualified person as part of the governance structure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How many members of the board are mandated under the bill?
I think it's about... I don't have the...
Yeah.
My mind now, Karen, but I think it's about 7 or 8.
Yeah, it's usually 7 or 9.
I might be correct.
Yeah. And how many independent board directors are mandated to be appointed?
Three. That's I'm sure. No, it's three.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Because you'd have others. I mean, at one point, Senator Escudero said na yung mas maraming nilagay na pera, dapat mas marami sila sa board. Or is it one representative per agency?
It's Dambank has one, DBP has one. No? But this is the MIC governance structure. Later on, the MIC, through the MIF, will invest in particular projects. That's where the prorated directors will come in. For example, it invests in, let's say, a toll road. And then it will take 40% of that toll road. So the corresponding directors will come from the MIC. And the 60% obviously will come from the private sector. So that will be a structure later on when the MIC starts to invest. But from a MIC level, from the overall fund level, it's already specified in the law.
How would you define the Maharlika Investment Fund or the corp of it? Is this a GOCC? What's the definition?
It's a GOCC, Karen.
Okay.
And in fact, it's also important to note that it's not exempted from the Procurement Act.
Yeah, yeah.
So meaning everything it buys goes through the Procurement Act. Before, again, no, before it was not there. No, actually, in the original version that was transmitted to us, they were exempted. So they can buy whatever they want without going through the Procurement Act. Mm-hmm. Now they're part of the Procurement Act. They're part of the GCG Act. They're part of the dividends law also. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And given that this is a GOCC, does this or has this fulfilled the constitutional requirement when creating GOCCs? Could this be thumbed down by the Supreme Court?
Well, that is the point. That was a point raised by Senator Escudero. He made a very good case on the requirements to form a GOCC. And I think throughout the discussion in the committee, throughout the discussion in plenary, that was laid out. And in my personal opinion, no, it's my personal opinion that was discussed during the hearing.
Okay. All right. Now moving forward, there are those who doubt that this would make a big difference, right? Because the models of the sovereign wealth fund in other countries, it's coming from a surplus. It's in reinvested back into the country for infrastructure and also the improvement of human capital. So that's the model in other countries. But in this particular case, we are operating from funds coming from agencies that are actually investing in other areas as well. So ang tanong dito ng ilan is just how much, is there a target of some kind with a kind of ROI that this fund is expected to receive?
Well, Karen, based on the hearings that I attended and based on my own research, this type of funds have evolved throughout the years. Mm. Not all countries will have resources. Mm. Not all countries are like Norway,
uh-oh,
who has unlimited amount of oil, or the Middle Eastern countries. But it doesn't mean that if you don't have resources, you cannot put up sovereign wealth funds.
Mm-mm.
In fact, one of the objectives of the sovereign wealth funds, based on my research, is to multiply the capital that was invested. Mm. In fact, during the initial hearing of this bill, I was under the impression that sovereign wealth funds should come from resources, should come from oil and gas. But after conducting the hearings, after listening to the debates, apparently, there are different models of sovereign wealth funds. A case in point will be Indonesia, wherein they put in some money from oil, some money from their General Appropriations Act. And one of the benefits of doing so is you multiply. There's a multiplier effect on the sovereign wealth fund, meaning you can attract private capital to come in and double, triple, or even quadruple the capital that you infused in the fund.
Mm-mm. Okay. Senator Aimee Marcos, the sister of the president, has brought up very good points. If the fund is meant to invest in projects, but aren't agencies doing that? Don't we have the budget for that as it is? So what's the difference? Kumbaga, ang tanong ni Senator Marcos, anong plus dito? If it'll invest in infrastructure, aren't agencies, aren't you earmarking money for infrastructure too? Isn't that what you do with a budget?
What I appreciated during the debates from the sponsor, from Senator Villar, is the multiplier effect. That was one of the benefits that I took note. Like, for example, if you put let's say right now, no, there's about 125 billion in capital. You can increase that. There's a multiplier effect for that because private capital will come in. Multilateral banks can come in. There's a show of confidence whenever government invests in a particular project that other funds would want to come in and join in that project. It's also important to note that one of the introductions that I made is there's no sovereign guarantee. So meaning the fund will have to evaluate squarely the projects that they will be investing in. So it will operate just like any other fund, investment fund, private investment fund for that matter.
Okay, so if that's the case, there's no sovereign guarantee, it operates like a private fund. The problem is pera ito ng bayan. Right? It is coming from government. So paano po ito ngayon kapag nalugi ang fund? And frankly, all funds in the world right now aren't performing well. Huh? There's not one fund that's doing well last year or this year.
Karen, investment funds like this take a long view on investing. You don't look at 1 year, you don't look at 2 years, you look at 10 years, you look at longer than that. Definitely, economic activities are very cyclical. You can lose money today, but you can make a lot of money next year. You know? So you have to take a long view, especially the fund is not looking to make a quick buck. You know? It's not designed to invest in stock market and cash out next month. You know? It's designed to build the country. It's designed to contribute to economic development, which is a long view, which is long term. So when you invest in toll roads, you actually, toll roads take years to build.
But then why do you need a Maharlika investment fund nga to invest in a toll road? When in the Philippines, toll roads are frankly, I mean, Senator, let's be honest, toll roads in the Philippines are built via PPPs. All the toll roads that I'm in, the reason the public pays is because we are paying back what the private sector has spent for that toll road. So that's what I want to understand. Diba? Okay, you give me an example of a toll road. But who's built the toll roads? San Miguel. Private companies, they're building it now. And we pay for it as a consumer. I pass the Skyway every day. Do we need a Maharlika fund for more Skyways? It's being done by the private sector and the government. So that isn't new.
Correct, Karen. There's a big deficit in terms of infrastructure in our country. There's not enough San Miguel's, there's not enough Metro Pacific, there's not enough conglomerates in the country. If we have 100 of them, then so be it. No, we don't need the Maharlika Investment Fund. But they're also limited. San Miguel can only build 1, 2, 3 toll roads at a time. But we need 100 toll roads to develop the country. I'll give you a case in point. The Panay Island interconnection. That's an important project, but the private sector cannot invest because their capital is already tied up in other projects. That's a project that the Maharlika Investment Fund can look at and operationalize.
But how will
the Bataan Cavite Interlink? Yeah. That's another project that they can look at. These type of projects are important to nation building, and we need it tomorrow.
I'm with you there.
Is to build as quickly as possible.
So I'm with you there. But if, let's say, the model is the Maharlika Fund will build these toll roads, the goal of the fund is to be profitable. So they'll have to run the toll road. That's correct.
Correct. Well, there's so many models. They can run the toll road, they can outsource the O&M. They can do a hybrid PPP. There's so many models. What's important there? The toll road gets built. tomorrow.
Okay.
That's important. No?
Okay.
So there's so many models that we can follow. The world, you know, this type of financing and this type of fund mechanism is also evolving. The Sovereign Wealth Fund 100 years ago, based on the debates and the research that we conducted, is not the same now. Mm-hmm. And no, the financing mechanisms are evolving. No, mm-hmm. So that's why the fund actually is built to the changing times.
Okay, now a former cabinet official said that the hard part is if the Maharlika Fund doesn't earn or the Maharlika Fund isn't profitable, it could result to higher taxes, and the Philippines could be borrowing more money. Right now, I think, how much is the debt? It's, what are we at, 13.9 trillion? Is that correct, Senator?
Yes,
right?
Correct.
So we have a debt that's increasing. So is that possible? What happens if the fund loses? I mean, yes, you said it, it's a fund. It can lose.
Yes.
But the problem with this fund is it's the people's money in the fund in one way or the other, right? Galing gobyerno po yung fund, all of it. So paano po ito? Could it result in higher taxes?
In fact, when I talk to the economists and fund managers now, the tone has shifted.
Okay.
After they've read the Senate version or the approved version, the tone now is, oh, we have put in so much restrictions and safeguards mm-hmm. that it's very difficult for the fund to operate. Mm-hmm. No? Of course, we have yet to see that. No, that's their initial thoughts. No, but mm-hmm. my point there is we have put safeguards to minimize the downside.
Mm-hmm.
The upside is there, but we put safeguards to make sure that public funds are protected and people who will abuse will be prosecuted. In fact, in the bill, there are 3 pages of penalties for those who will abuse the fund and those who will take advantage or corrupt officials mm-hmm. in the fund.
Okay. Another question is the fund is modeled, well, one of the models is the Indonesia fund. And Sulita Monsod said the Indonesia fund's only been there 2 years. But what's unique about the Indonesia fund is I think it's open to private financing. Is it correct, Senator?
Yes, yes.
So the Maharlika Investment Fund, is there, I don't know if you'd call it, is there a provision in the fund that opens it to private investors at one point?
Yes, Karen, and it can do so at the project level. There's several levels. Now, for example, the fund will invest in a toll road infrastructure. That infrastructure can be opened up to private capital, uh-huh. whether it's a direct operating company or another fund that will
yeah.
invest.
And the fear
it can do so.
And the fear of some is that with this in the Philippines, it can be used for money laundering.
We have very strict money laundering laws, Karen. I think dealing with money laundering as a country is a separate topic, but just the same, we have very strict money laundering law, and it's getting stricter. We just amended the anti-money laundering law a few years back to upgrade it, and we continuously update the law so that it will respond to the different schemes that money launderers are doing. Mm. In fact, we have a whole department of anti-money laundering group in the BSP, just monitoring and preventing money laundering from happening in our country.
All right. Well, Senator, we don't have enough time this morning, but I really appreciate you taking the time to explain and give some clarifications on the Maharlika Investment Fund. I hope to see you again, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen.